51% attack is based on the idea that you amass more computational power than everyone else combined. There's two ways to exploit this: double spend own tokens or cashed out through short selling a coin that is now worth less because people trust it less. Hi, this is Carsten from Hacking Matters, where each week we explore the challenges in cybersecurity. Today we're going back to blockchains and look at what might be the oldest crypto attack, an attack that applies to virtually all chains and has already been exploited on some of them. We're talking about the 51% attack, which is embedded in the design of many blockchains. Basically, it's an attack that arises from the majority rule. Let's step back for just a moment and look at the premise of blockchain. Here we have a decentralized global system with no authority that can control decisions about transactions and about the rules of the game. Instead, we have majority rule, and that sounds good, that sounds democratic. The way that majority rule is implemented in many chains leaves it open to temporary takeovers of the control. If somebody can amass 51% of the control, then they get to decide, for instance, which transactions happen and which ones don't. The 51% attack targets the mechanism by which blocks are chained together, hence blockchain. All blockchains are based on the idea that a block predetermines what the next block will look like in terms of, for instance, a hash. You say, find a block that complies with this hash. And so, because each block sets up the next block in perpetuity, you're constantly racing. And in Bitcoin and its derivatives, this race is through pure computational power. You're trying different options until somebody somewhere in the world gets lucky, they solve this puzzle, and then everyone moves on to the next block and the next block and the next block. That's how the chain comes into existence. And why do people do this? Because whoever solves the challenge gets a reward, transaction fees, or mining. So people invest computational resources, but they get more back on average. And hence, a business case is created for people to do this all over the world. What happens now if different parties in the system find a new block almost at the same time before they're able to learn about the other finding? Now you need some kind of a conflict resolution where you basically say whoever propagates first wins. But that's not exactly how it's implemented. Rather, the ultimate determining factor is the longest chain. Basically, if you can present a chain of blocks going all the way back to the first seed of Bitcoin that is longer than any other chain in the system, that is the determining chain. That becomes the new reality. So the 51% attack is based on the idea that you amass more computational power than everyone else combined, but you withhold your information for some period of time. So your 51 or more percent of the computational power outpaces everyone else in generating new blocks on average. And you get to decide which transactions to include and which to exclude from your alternative reality to the chain. And at some point, minutes or even hours later, you announce this publicly, and because your chain is longer than the current public chain, you win. At least that's the design of these systems, and there'll be some confusion in the market, but technically, your chain becomes the new truth. There's two ways to exploit this. Either you're spending some of your own tokens while you withhold information, and then you do not report the transaction in which you spend your tokens. That is, as soon as you announce your alternate reality, the coins are back to you. And whatever benefits you got, maybe you traded this for another coin, maybe there was some real world transaction where somebody gave you real goods on some street corner, you hold on to those benefits, but you get the coins back so you can double spend. So that's the obvious way to use a 51% attack to gain some benefits. But it's also kind of the most obvious way, so it's clear which transactions you withheld from the chain. So the second possibility is probably more likely to happen in the future, and that is sowing distrust in the system. If you do withhold the longest chain for some period of time, and then you do break everyone's reality by announcing this alternate reality, you'd sow confusion in that market. If you know that there's impact to the trust and the reputation of a chain will happen, you can, through short selling, make a lot of money. So the 51% attack can be used either to double spend or to impact the reputation and thereby the market price of a coin, making money either way. How much money are we talking about that the attacker would need? For something like Bitcoin, we're talking about several million dollars per hour to be 51%, to rent all of the computational capacity. So you're unlikely to do that against Bitcoin. But there's so many smaller chains. One that comes to mind is Litecoin. They're trading at several billion market cap, so significant value captured on this chain. And for a few thousand dollars, you can amass more computational resources than the entire existing chain combined right now, thereby launch these 51% attacks. To recap, what are the steps to launch these 51% attacks? First, you amass more computational resources for some period of time than everyone else combined, which for many chains isn't all that much. And then you start solving these cryptographic puzzles. However, you're not telling anyone else about your solutions, and you're progressing on the chain faster than anyone else. You get to choose when to announce your alternate reality, thereby invalidating the recent history that people know about the chain, and you get to replace it with your own history. The hacker then can either double spend their own tokens or more likely have cashed out through short selling a coin that is now worth less because people trust it less. How do we mitigate 51% attacks? Three ways come to mind. One is size. Size matters here. The larger your crypto ecosystem is, the less likely that somebody gets 51% of the computational power at any point in time. Bitcoin is a good example, but then there are Bitcoin derivatives, like for instance, Bitcoin Gold. That was hacked through a 51% attack years ago. And there are others like Litecoin that we mentioned that use the same algorithms, but are significantly smaller in terms of number of participants. Now, there's a little bit of a trade-off here. Of course, the crypto world wants more specialized chains. They want a chain for real estate trading and maybe a chain linked to the stock market and a chain linked to the bond market. Whatever ideas you have in the future, you want a specialized chain. But if size matters, you don't want this chain to exist in isolation. So in theory, you'd now have to choose between joining a large existing ecosystem that might be less vulnerable to something like a 51% attack, or choose the flexibility of creating your own small chain. Now, there's a good compromise in between through parachains, basically creating a small chain but linking it to a larger chain. Polkadot, for instance, is one of the ecosystems that allows that, and where there's hundreds of projects, all of them specialized into various use cases, but they all rely on the same underlying asset, the Polkadot. And because of its size, that's much less likely to fall for a 51% attack. The second strategy, probably the most important one, is to define majority rule differently. Bitcoin and its derivatives, Ethereum in its early generation, they did rely on this proof of work. You have to try out different computational inputs to find the hash that matches, and then you win this mining step and set up the next challenge. That's very computationally wasteful. Trying random hashes does nothing for the world other than proving that you did put in the work and that you're earning your reward. So many newer chains have introduced a different system called proof of stake, where the majority isn't who happens to be active right now, which can be highly volatile. Rather, it's defined through ownership of the chain. So basically, the more tokens you earn, the more you get to decide in voting. So basically, money begets money. It does feel a little feudalistic. Big landowners, or what crypto calls whales, gobbling up big chunks of a chain and then earning money based on that. But it does keep them honest too. They have a deep interest in this chain to have a high reputation and to be trustworthy. So all kind of chain politics aside, we're not talking about those on this channel, security-wise, it's a very good idea to move to a proof of stake system, because it's much more difficult and costly to amass 51% of the ownership of something than 51% of whatever computational resources happen to be active at any one point in time. Polkadot, once again, has implemented this from day one, but other chains have migrated to this. Most notably, Ethereum took them over 7 years to go from proof of work to proof of stake, but finally there. So it's a good security uplift. Also, it's a much greener technology now. As you can imagine, running through all of these crypto hashing challenges unnecessarily used a lot of electricity, which today just isn't needed anymore. Older chains like Bitcoin, they won't be able to transition like this just because they're too entrenched and inflexible. The third factor that makes chains less likely to experience a 51% attack is governance. A way for the chain to change its own rules, like Ethereum did when transitioning from proof of work to proof of stake, was a major change, in fact, a series of changes over the course of many years. And having the ability to do that would give you an ultimate option of reversing somebody's hacking activity. So having some level of control over the future of your chain allows the community to basically correct mistakes that were done within the rules of the system. So if somebody were to amass 51% at some point in time, and the community thereafter agrees that that was fraudulent and malicious, they could change the rules to basically say, we erase that alternate reality and go back to the reality everyone had already agreed upon. Now that's tricky by itself, having a governance model. Like all democracies, there's trade-off choices and there's no perfect answers. We have a whole video on the 5 most common mistakes in blockchains that are complicated, like ones that have their own governance. So do go check that out to see that introducing governance is not an easy win, but rather one hard-earned. However, having governance at all is a deterrent to possible 51% attackers because they know that they're not necessarily assured that they can hold on to their gains. Rather, it could be that retroactively their gains are taken away from them again. And there have already been cases where chain governance has taken back money from criminals to kind of correct for mistakes that were done within the rules of the system, but still treated everyone else as unfairly. So there's precedent for both 51% attack and people correcting through chain governance. Put those two together, a criminal who's considering a 51% attack would probably go for a chain without governance. Allow me to comment on one more aspect of this. Several of these factors that make 51% attacks less likely are diverting a little bit from the core premise of a blockchain system as being this immutable, forever, rules-based system where humans just cannot interfere anymore, and for better or worse. So your central bank cannot interfere, your government cannot interfere, no one can. Through introducing things like proof of stake, that is a lot of control in the hands of a few large landowners, or governance, again, the way of rules to be changed retroactively, you do divert a little bit from this pure essential blockchain idea where everything is determined by code and can never be changed anymore. So there are trade-off choices, and as crypto as a technology is progressing, different chains answer these trade-off choices differently. So it is an evolutionary race right now to determine what will become of crypto. But security is always a consideration. So if you're a security professional, you can make a big difference in securing these chains, especially in aspects like governance. So do check out that other video if you're interested in this topic. And if you're interested in anything else, as always, let us know in the comments below. We do this for you, so tell us what you're curious about. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed today's episode, please show it with a like and subscribe, and we'll see you next week. Happy hacking.